Welcome back to Inclusive Design 24, year 2019, brought to you in partnership with our gold supporters, Barclays Access and Intopia. Don't forget you can subscribe to Inclusive Design 24 on YouTube by visiting youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 and hitting that happy subscribe button. It wants you to click it. You can follow ID24Conf on Twitter, and if you have questions for the presenter, tweet them using the ID24 hashtag. We will ask them at the end of the session, even if we don't like them. Okay, strike that part from the script. As a reminder, ID24 is a respectful community with a code of conduct. That code of conduct is available on the website, inclusivedesign24.org. It is linked from the footer, so you can bounce over there and check it out. Also, a shout out to some of our listeners. We have folks who are following us and watching from Greece and Poland right now. So thank you for joining us, and everyone else who is in a time zone that means that they should be in bed instead.
Next up, we have Bryn Anderson, who will be speaking on the subject of Pinch and Zoom.
Hello, everyone. I hope you can hear me. Yes, I'm going to be talking about pinch and zoom, pinching and zooming, which is something I do a lot of on my mobile phone. But this is actually a bit broader than that. It's really about low vision users in general, with a caveat that I'm very biased about how I use technology and how I engage with the internet. So this is a bit more of a personal insight, but hopefully it is representative to some extent. Well, I know it's representative to some extent. And most of all, I hope it's insightful. Before I get going, sort of before we dive into the deep end, as it were, just a couple of things I wanted to mention. I work for a company called SiteImprove. We provide accessibility testing tools amongst other subscription services. We also, however, have a free Chrome extension if you did want to run that on your website. Just go and download it from the Chrome store. Just have a Google for SiteImprove accessibility Chrome extension. We also have an accessibility statement generator. This is another free resource if you are going through the process of building an accessibility statement. There's a widget that will guide you through that. And finally, a world map that we launched earlier in the year, version one of this world map, basically giving an overview of accessibility scores per country and also within sectors within that country as well. Sorry about that. I'm kind of eating the microphone here. So, and I know that there'll be some like nasal breathing going on. So I do apologize for that. But in the name of having a slightly louder audio, hopefully you'll agree that it's the right thing to do. Anyway, let's go. I'm going to start with a video, a mobile phone video here, a screen share video. I'm just going to mute the noise. I've clicked on, I've gone into an email and I've clicked a link through to a website. I want to book a hotel room and I'm presented with a cookie banner with a weird kind of endless nothingness scroll down the bottom. I'm trying to find obviously the way to get past this cookie banner. There's some weird buttons on there. There's some information, links, controls that say hide cookies. There's some clipped text at the top of the cookie banner as well, but definitely no obvious way to close this thing. And this was a genuine accident. Before, obviously, in the build up to this presentation, I suppose my brain was open to these types of things because I wanted to showcase them to you guys, but I really genuinely just stumbled across this at home. And it took me a long time. This is all happening real time. It took me a really long time to figure out how to close it. And the solution to close it was to go into my Android operating system settings, find the font size setting that I had bumped up because I need it bumped up. And I had to reduce it to an uncomfortable level to go back to the browser. At this point, I was pretty turned off by the whole thing, but I was determined to close this cookie banner and to see exactly what had to be done. So I've now got a submit button down the bottom. It's clipped, though. The word preferences, I'm guessing, is clipped. And there's still some actions that need to be taken before I can actually hit it. It's just grayed out. It's got a sort of low contrast view. So no feedback there when I tried tapping it. Eventually, I figure it out and I'm able to close the cookie banner. And then my, in theory, then my actual user experience begins of trying to book a hotel. So in many ways, that kind of, you could probably turn off now. But don't do that. No, I'm only joking. I'm going to talk and explain a little bit about what's going on here and look at some of those things in more detail. But that is quite indicative of the challenge that we are facing. So who am I? I'm, as I mentioned, a product owner at Sightimprove. I'm visually impaired. I was born with albinism, which comes with some sort of pre-baked, if you like, visual impairments. And without going into all of those, the main thing to be aware of is that I cannot drive and I cannot see things close up. So I struggle with distance and I struggle with things up close. And very significantly, I cannot correct that vision with glasses or surgery. So that's what's going on there. I'm not blind, however, which might seem obvious to you. But I think it's important to point out, especially as so often we talk about, visual impairments, affecting blind people and accessibility being for users that are blind and screen readers and so on, blah, blah, blah. However, if we look at the statistics, according to the World Health Organization in general, in the very broad sense, there are 1.3 billion people with a visual impairment. The majority of that, so 97% of that number, are made up of people with distance and near vision impairments. And then there's 3% that are actually blind. So a very, very, very small proportion of people with visual impairments are actually blind. But of course, when we're talking about a visual medium, that makes that 3% very, very, very significant. Because if you cannot perceive visually, the device, the medium that is delivering the information, then you need another way to do that. Hence the whole screen reader thing and the screen reader focus. So an intermediary essentially. But anyway, of the 97% that are left, there is approximately 20% of those, or 250 million, that have low vision. And I am included in that bracket. So again, it's a massive, massive number that we're talking about here. And we're not talking about, issues that can easily be corrected by glasses. What do we know about low vision users? Well, thanks to WebAIM, who's done some, they do some fantastic research, and they have done a survey 2018, the second survey, I believe, and it provides us with some insights into some assistive technologies that low vision users like myself use. The top one, around 50% of the respondents said they use screen magnification software or system settings, which we'll look at that shortly. Number two was screen reader. I was super surprised to see that, if I'm honest, because I don't use a screen reader. And of course, being a narcissist and that, I think that everyone does what I do. I was wrong. Followed by browser zoom controls. So zooming in and out of the browser, we'll have a look at that in a minute. And also browser text sizing settings, and we shall look at that. The reason that I've sort of yellowed, highlighted these three things, screen magnification and system settings, browser zoom controls, and browser text sizing, is that's all about making things bigger, which really kind of speaks to my need here, and for people that have a visual acuity problem. Now, if that acuity problem is severe enough, then screen reading is also an option. And I do use it occasionally. I just don't use it as part of my everyday. So we could say that we are a group of users that generally needs to adjust the size of content or sometimes have it read back to us. So if we were creating a kind of user story or requirement around this group of people, So it's not just about making things bigger. It could also be about maybe you have the center of your vision is obstructed through some sort of condition, like cataracts or something like that. And so being zoomed in and having everything big would make it even more challenging. So being zoomed out might be your requirement there. So I think to be sort of, you know, fair to factor everyone in, it's about adjusting sizes, about preferences, my preferences, essentially, and not, you know, the businesses that I'm interacting with's preferences. That is the key. So let's have a quick look at some desktop settings. I'm going to move things around a little bit. Where am I going? Okay, so right now I've got, I'm in my Windows system settings. I have scale and layout to 150, resolution 16 by 900. That's basically what I have this monitor set to. This is I'm actually in a hotel right now, so it's not my monitor, but it looks like it's around 40 inches. So it's a big old monitor there, and I've got a low resolution to make things bigger. Because that's how we like it. So I'm going to change this for you. I'm going to go with the recommended. I'm also going to get rid of the zoom or the scaling. And immediately we can see, I haven't even opened a browser, and we've got a very, very, very different look and feel. There's this huge amount of white space, which, you know, could be good, could be bad, but it's certainly different. When we're talking about how the user experiences content. So let's go and have a look in the browser. We've got Amazon here. We've got Walmart here. We've got, I need more time. We've got SAP Concur, the my favorite expense program. not really, but anyway, an expense programs application. And we've got the ID24 website as well. And what I wanted to show you was how this looks, maybe how these websites were intended to be delivered when they were built. And now let's have a look at them when we bump everything up. So I'm going to pop that back on. I have to zoom, physically stick my face in the monitor here to see what I'm doing. Keep the change. Gonna bang that up to 150. All right. And now let's go and have a look at the browsers. Right, very different feel already. We've lost a lot of the white space, inverted commas, if you know what I mean, here. However, everything fits on the page very nice. I haven't even zoomed into the browser, and this is looking pretty good. Concur, however, present some different challenges, but in the name of time, I want to tackle two things at once. So I'm going to go back to my presentation here and talk to you about desktop browser zooming. So there's a couple of things that we want to look for here when we adjust the size of things. We want to make sure when we're zooming into it that content responds, and there's a sort of a nice reflow of content, probably into a single column layout from whatever it was before, and we want to check for any loss of information. When I say want to check, sounds like we're going to do a load of testing. And we are kind of testing in the sense that whenever I'm browsing websites, I'm kind of testing, because I'm pushing those websites in a way that they maybe haven't been designed to work for me. So let's go back here. I'm going to zoom in now to this website. That's 125, 150, 175, 200. Things are looking pretty good for the ID24 website. Granted, it is a seemingly sort of simple, has a seemingly simple layout compared to the next one, which is Concur, for my expense claims, as an insight into my spending here. So immediately, I haven't even zoomed into the browser, and I can already tell you that there's a load of content that's missing. So if I zoom out, now you'll start to see in the bottom half of the window, if you can see that, actually the expenses, the main focus of this application, are hidden. So at this distance, I cannot do the work. It's too far away. So I zoom in, and for setting my own preferences, zooming into the browser, I've completely lost the whole purpose of the application. Zooming in to even just 200% here, it just renders this completely unusable, unfortunately. Moving on to Walmart. Walmart does zoom nicely, content reflows. We've got a single column here, which is great. It's looking good, but as we zoom in, even we're not even at 400% yet, and we've got this huge sticky, I don't know what you call it, sort of header bar, plus a feedback button. So at 400%, even if I enter full screen browsing, I've got content is getting obstructed here. So this, I don't know if you could call this, maybe you could call this invasive, but it's definitely, it's a kind of persistent navigation that I certainly don't need. And it's taking up a lot of real estate here. Let us get out of that full screen. Ooh, opening up everything here. Oh, skip to main content. That's a big old link there. And then Amazon, finally, just for this, Amazon's looking good right now. Before any zoom or when we start to zoom, we can see that it introduces a horizontal scroll. There's a 2.1 success criteria for this reflow, and it's really looking to avoid two-dimensional scrolling. And simply that's introduced because it is super frustrating and a strain on the user to have to consider mentally what's going on and physically to have to look for information by scrolling left and right and up and down. Jolly good. Let's go back to this thing. Very conscious of time. I'm very paranoid about going over it. So we'll just have to see where we go. So we had a look at these. I didn't show you the Domino's pizza example. I did include it, however, in the screenshot here because I wanted to just acknowledge that it's been the center of a lot of controversy, of some legal case. But actually, I don't have a problem using it at all. And maybe that's surprising for some people who maybe don't work every day with accessibility. But one person's problem is not necessarily another person's problem. While this website may have not worked for someone using a screen reader who can't perceive what's visually on the screen, as a low vision user who can perceive a fair amount of information, I didn't have a problem using that at all. And it has a responsive design and everything. So that's good. Or interesting, at least. To point out. Next up, desktop screen magnification. I'm not going to spend loads of time on this one, but I'm going to demonstrate it to you. So this is about it's about zooming in. Sorry, it's about magnifying and not zooming. So we're like magnifying the whole operating system here. So it's not specific to the browser, like the zoom, and I can move around my mouse. I don't like it because I find it really disorientating. However, it is super useful when I am on just like a really small display. And a really small display for me is a normal laptop. So if I do need to find information, if I'm using that Concur app and I have to submit an expense, I could use the magnification over the zoom. Definitely not a preference. And I think particularly for forms and things like that here, the relationship between things, elements on the page is really pushed. So you really need to know where you are and how have a good sense of where you're on the screen. I'm going to just show you something. I've opened up a new tab. It's opened up Google search. It opens a responsive design version of Google search. Which is cool. But of course, I'm not experiencing the whole responsiveness because I'm zoomed in or magnified, as I should say. But look what happens when I actually start to type something in the search field. The whole thing completely moves, is pretty disorientating. If you're not familiar, not so technology minded or whatever, you might wonder what the hell is going on. It's basically moved my search up to the URL, which is fine, but very confusing when you're zoomed in. And there's all sorts of things like that that are confusing. The main one that, that people often talk about is form fields and form labels. Let me come out of here and go back into the presentation. I've got an example of Facebook up here. I just grabbed something. Basically, there's obviously, well, looks like there's some contrast issues with the placeholder text within these form fields. Placeholder text on its own is not really a good idea, but the point here is that when you're zoomed into this, the information about what you need to put in the label is kind of intrinsically connected. That's really important for form fields when people are zoomed, magnified into their content, that you have all the information you need regarding the input field that, right there in front of you. Ooh, what a lot of talking. And we're not even halfway through, I don't think. So let me hurry up. Let me just check the time. Okay, sweet. So mobile system settings, you had a look at, you got an insight into this a little bit earlier when I was showing you the cookie issue that I had with that hotel website. Basically, my default setting, or when I got my phone, I immediately went and found the screen zoom, bumped it up, and I immediately went and found the font size, bumped it up. The reason that I haven't bumped up the font size all the way is if I do that, I can barely get any words, more than one word on a line. So that's kind of a limitation of I guess, a mobile display. And it's really interesting that, and you know, be very interested to hear your thoughts about that, because this whole sort of text resize and low vision browsing, visual browsing on mobile phones feels a bit like a sort of a square into a circle. The whole device is not really geared around that. And certainly a lot of websites haven't been designed with that in mind. And we will see that in more detail. Okay, so mobile zooming, what have we got? So basically, before my operating system setting changes, I've got on the left-hand side here, we're looking at the BBC, everything looks nice and intended. Granted, it's massive on this screen right now, but when it's in my phone, obviously it's much smaller. And then on the right-hand side, we've got the lovely Boris Johnson and Angela Merkel talking about you know what. And if we play this, we'll just get an indication. So different text sizes. So the text scaling seems to be working for some elements and not others. UK politics was a little category there that's really small to see. So I needed to zoom into that, pinch and zoom to zoom into that. So I've kind of got this sort of weird, varied experience of massive text and small text, which means that I'm actually utilizing different techniques in order to consume all of the information on the page, which isn't really ideal. Let's go down to Outlook. Let's have a look at this one here. So I open an email, all is going well. I scroll down the email and then there's kind of some sort of formatting or thing within the body of the email. I try to zoom into it and it's shaky. It's like shaking around and it's really, I'm using two fingers now to scroll left and right just to read an email. I mean, that is just not cool. you know, it's really, really frustrating. So I'm more likely not to bother reading these types of emails on my phone. I will wait until I get to the office. But as you know, when you get to the office, there's a million things to do. So you probably just don't read the email. So then let us move down. Oh, it looks like the same thing. So we talked about screen magnification on desktop. I've now got a little video of my Android home screen. On this is a Samsung Note 8, by the way. And when I play this video, I want to basically see what the weather is. I triple tap to zoom into it because it's absolutely tiny, that text, to discover that I've actually got the wrong region set. So that's how often I use that little use that little app. But that's kind of interesting. You've got this triple tap function on the mobile phone that essentially triggers the screen magnification, which is really cool, and I do use it. But unlike like the Chrome desktop browsing, I cannot pinch and zoom into the operating system in the same way that I cannot control mouse scroll or control plus zoom into the Windows operating system. But I do have the triple tap, which allows me to basically turn on that magnification. And the whole thing's a little bit more like ergonomic, using your fingers to minimize and enlarge stuff, which is super nice to use. I'm losing myself in all of these examples. I can't even think where we're going next. Text scaling, text resize. So does it work? Do websites utilize this? Is there any truncated text? Is there any clipped content? Is there any missing content? So quite a few things to factor in. I'm going to go back to the browser, and I'm going to show you what I'm talking about. I'm going to take Amazon here, and I'm going to take the ID24 website here. I'm just going to reset the zoom to 100%, and I'm going to go into Chrome's settings. And I'm going to look for font size, and I'm going to put that down to very small. And then I'm going to go back to the ID24 website. And as you can see, that setting has adjusted the size of the text on the screen. I'll go to Amazon. Doesn't look like anything's happened here. So I'm going to go back to my settings. I'm going to whack it all the way up to very large. What is that? Font size tiny. Oh, no. Bang that up. And then we'll see what is done. Okay, so ID24 working like a dream. And let's go and have a look at Amazon. No change. And I can, you know, in some ways I can totally understand that. There's a lot going on here. But, you know, without being, you know, I use Amazon a lot, and I think all of the websites I feel like, did I mention this already? Anyway, all of the websites that I'm using today, I'm using because I use them. It's not because I've gone to look for bad examples. I'm using them because, with the exception of Walmart, I actually use these websites really regularly. So they're definitely doing a lot right, but there's some things that could be improved. For example, I've got some preferences set in my browser, and they're not really being respected here by this website, which is a little bit frustrating. They are being respected, however, here, which is super nice, and that kind of creates a sense of loyalty, which is probably a conversation for another day. okay, let's go back to this thing here. I'm now in my Uber app. Well, at least I've got a couple of screenshots of it. So when on the left-hand side, this was the intended user experience without any zoom or text scaling turned on in my operating system. And then on the right-hand side, we've got basically with those, the zoom and the text size scaling up. I'm just going to point out the obvious here. We've got a message that says, good morning, Bryn, on the left. And on the right, it just says, good morning, dot, dot, dot. Well, it still kind of works, right? But then underneath that, we've got on the left, so the non-zoomed version, where to, as a call to action. And to the right of that, seemingly almost like in the same input field, we've got schedule. There is a little divider in there, which, well, whatever. You may see that or you may not see that. But so where to and schedule is two calls to action. On the right, where to is just WH. And schedule is there. Now I know this because I do, but if I didn't know this and I went into this app with my operating system settings adjusted to my preferences, perhaps I would only ever think that you can schedule something and wonder why the hell Uber have got a option there. So that's kind of cool. Cool to point out. Not cool, I'm realizing that my home postcode is there, but that's all good. That's fine. There's loads of people live at that postcode. so yeah, that's just an interesting thing there. We're now talking about valuable information. Is, yes, there might be clipping, there might be truncation, but is the value being communicated in what's left? And I think you could argue that WH isn't really enticing me to go into that input field. A couple of other things here. Videos, I'm not going to play them. I'm just going to scroll and look for something. This is me ordering an Uber. Okay, so I'm about to confirm my Uber, but you can see the actual price of the Uber is 11 to 1, it looks like, which of course is not right. It's 11 to 1 and something else, but the 1 is clipped because I'm zoomed in. I have my settings set. When we look on the other screen on the right, it's a continuation of the journey. There's a couple of other things to point out. I've got a number plate that now says VW. So it's the last two letters of the number plate. I know nothing about cars, but if I need the number plate to figure out which car is mine, is VW enough information? In fact, I mean, to be honest, the fact that I have to look at the number plate to figure it out doesn't really work for me anyway, because I'd have to probably lie down in front of the car to read the number plate. But, you know, just worth pointing out, if I scroll down a little bit, you will see also that I've now got the full price. So after I've confirmed the Uber, it now tells me it's in fact 11 to 14 pounds, so not 19 pounds or not 12 pounds or 13 pounds, whatever. So, you know, that's a pretty significant piece of information. And there is a little bit of clipping on this button here, which I'm not quite sure what it says.
Right.
So let's go past all that stuff. We're now looking at Monzo and the desperate state of affairs of my bank account, although this was some time ago. I've only got £5.72 in there. On the left, we've got the intended UX. On the right, we've got the scaled up, zoomed in experience. And there's a lot of overlaid content. Things are looking a little bit messy, to say the least. Down the bottom, we've got some buttons that say SU and AC. It's all pretty cryptic. Monzo updated this. Unfortunately, though, they created even more noise and more kind of competing content in there. So that was a little bit disappointing. However, I'm still using it, aren't I? So, you know, that does say something, maybe about my willingness to put up with the poor user experience, and also the whole conversation about the sort of the value proposition, or the pros outweighing the cons. But it does render a lot of their features unusable, and it doesn't really encourage me to explore. That's for sure. What about screen reading? Hopefully you'll be able to hear this. It's a very...
Intel chief questioned on accusations whistleblower is a political hack. Main landmark, senior White House officials tried to lock down all details of a phone call between Donald Trump and the Ukrainian president, according to a whistleblower complaint against the US president. In the call, Mr. Trump pushed Volodymyr Zelensky to investigate his leading domestic political rival, Joe Biden.
All right, that's enough of that. It's basically narrator reading an article to me. Super handy, especially if I'm on the move. Obviously, this is actually a desktop version, so I'm more likely to use, my goodness me, I've forgotten what it is, TalkBack on a voice assistant on Android. To actually read this article to me. So I'm definitely not going to be able to read and walk. But yeah, I could definitely read and walk and listen. So that is a handy thing. And I do use it from time to time when I'm out and about. But to be honest, not really as part of my daily desktop user experience.
Intel chief question.
I've got an NVDA example here. So I'm actually I'm using magnifier. And I'm using the mouse to basically to point out what I want NVDA to read.
BBC News, White House tried to cover up details of Trump-Ukraine call. Senior White House officials tried to lock down all details of...
Hopefully you get the impression, I appreciate it's really quiet that actually, but the point is that the... I do know that people find this quite handy, being able to it can be exhausting reading, especially if you're trying to read with the magnification on and scroll left and right and do all that stuff together. Being able to just have, you know, the screen read to you where your cursor's at, you might have a general idea of where there is content, but reading that content might be really challenging. So being able to do that is really, really handy. Yep. Okay, cool. What else have we got down here? I've got just this was an example again of voice assistant reading a tweet.
Notifications. Recent tweet from Leonie. Hearing different voices from our digital community is exciting and vital. So see.
I mean, personally, I really, this is actually genuinely quite a practical application of voice assistant. There's never time to listen to tweets and retweets. I'm not a massive fan, to be honest, with Twitter, because every time, by the time I've composed my tweet, my crafted tweet, with my head buried in my keyboard or squinting at my screen, the conversation's moved on, which is a little bit frustrating. But it doesn't mean that I can't keep up with things, and I'd much rather listen than have to read. So that is definitely a practical application there. Voice input. Now, this is not doing voice input justice. There is so much possibility with voice input. I mentioned earlier that we have pretty much or predominantly a visual medium. There is some changes there. If you look at the new iOS, is it 13 features, so many cool things there. They're really pushing a change in how we interact with our devices. So just a quick example of me using WhatsApp.
Hi, Cree. I'm just going to be testing something here, so ignore my messages.
Which is pretty basic, but then check this out.
Again, I'm just testing something. I just wanted to demonstrate what it's like to use the speech to text functionality on this Android Note 8.
Super handy, very practical when I'm on the move, being able to say what I want instead of having to try and spell it out and delete it and make errors and mistakes and all of that stuff and click on the right input field and all of that is really not conducive to me as a low vision user, and definitely not when I'm out and about and on the move. So the more I could do with my voice, the better. As you can see, the actual conversion of my speech to text is pretty accurate there, which is very, very, very cool. And of course, being able to send a voice message in this, you know, context, in the context of a messenger app, is super handy. So, over time, I totally anticipate more sort of natural language search making its way out there. You can already, you know, query Google on the weather and all sorts of stuff, and then Google Home and Siri and all of these things. So definitely more of this to come. Leonie Watson does some really fantastic presentations on this topic, as do others. So I just wanted to, it definitely needed a mention here. But that's for definitely for another session. Jolly good. To summarize, I guess, what we've been talking about. And I think initially when I put this presentation together, I was very conscious of wanting to tell everyone how to make it all better. But in reality, all I've done is present a load of problems to you. Well, hopefully I've presented some insights that you can then understand where the problem is coming from. And it's up to you guys, I guess, to figure out ways to fix it. So a quick recap. Non-responsive content can be really challenging, namely when we lose information, which is a WCAG violation, of course, and when we're forced to use the horizontal scroll. In addition to vertical scroll. We've got competing content, as we saw in Monzo, too much information on the screen without a consideration for how things look when they scale and resize is very problematic. Sticky content, we saw with Walmart, they have a header kind of bar that takes up a lot of real estate when you're zoomed in. You can't get rid of it, which is very annoying. Clipped content, we didn't look at this, but this is Norwegian, and there's a button up there. I have no idea what it's for. Well, I do know because I have to use this application and can adjust my font settings, but really that's just killing the user experience. This display really is not ideal, and an absolute loss of information there to the user. Truncated content, as we saw in Uber, the WH example versus scheduled. Non-scaling content. So it was very hard to get Amazon, or we couldn't get Amazon to to respect the Google Chrome text sizing that I'd set, whereas, for example, the ID24 completely respected that. This is actually a screenshot from Amazon on a mobile phone, and part of the content does respect the text resizing. It's actually the cookie information that does, but the actual navigation and the breadcrumbs and the rest of it does not, for the most part, or at least in my light test that I did. And just to remind you all of the lovely intrusive, persistent, and sort of trapped experience I had when I wanted to book a hotel. So, on that lovely note, I've definitely reached my time. I would like to say thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Bryn. That was awesome. I appreciated all of the demos in there. That was pretty cool. Even if I almost got a heart attack when you started changing your screen resolution mid-presentation. So, Kathleen, have we got any questions?
Let me double check. So far, none other than a lot of excitement, particularly yes. For me, because I'm a huge fan of Pinch and Zoom, and I've had a lot of debates. Looking to see if it was any more. There is not. So there's been a lot of debates of, hey, well, browsers will allow you to Zoom now, so you don't need to change your, when you're developing, you don't have to change pixels to REM, relative units anymore. Mm. So we've had a lot of debates. So I'm very excited for what you have shown here to demonstrate, yes, indeed. this is still an issue. But I do have one question.
Yeah.
Are there any resources you can recommend for people that want to learn more about Pinch and Zoom?
Oh, you know what? That's I should know that, shouldn't I? but I actually don't have anything off the top of my head. And I think, you know, really what I wanted to try and achieve with this is to provide an insight not only as to how it is for myself, but you can also easily go and test this stuff. So the best resource really is to kind of experience it yourself, check it on your content. There's nothing to install. All of the stuff, well, with the exclusion of NVDA, all of the stuff comes shipped with these devices. But I mean, there are some great articles out there explaining the new WCAG 2.1 low vision resources. The W3C has one. It also comes with some, you know, some sort of persona user stories. And I think Glenda Sims also wrote a good article on it as well. So there's definitely content out there, but not a single resource as such that I'm aware of.
Well, actually, there's one other question I just will actually do, so I'm sorry. there is one really great question. What is the single most irritating thing you encounter on the web as a Zoom user?
Yes. Thank you for that question. The first thing that comes to my mind is the cookie content. Because it's definitely an afterthought. It's ironically for me, and it just sometimes I cannot close them. You know, the example that I shared today is not unique to that website at all. It's like a keyboard trap. You can't get rid of it unless you go and make some changes within your operating system. So it's a personal, like, it completely kills the experience or the kind of the thing that I'm trying to achieve. And then I think the other thing is the horizontal scrolling. On a mobile phone, like when you go open a website and it's all tiny, you're like, oh my God, are you serious? In this day and age, your website doesn't work on a mobile device. You're crazy, you know? But again, it really, whether you're on a desktop or mobile, like having to factor in and remember where things are on the screen because they're positioned out of the viewport is like a huge strain on the brain, really, you know. So I'd say there's those two things that I really, really struggle with, sort of persistent content that you cannot get rid of because it's never been tested
with a scaled up, zoomed in version of the website, and a horizontal zoom that essentially is not responsive content.
Wonderful. That is a really great explanation. I believe Adrian may have one more question. I'm going to see if he wants to jump in on that.
I do. I was going to pretend it was a question from the inner tubes, since you've outed me.
That's cool. That's cool.
It's all right. It's early where I am. All my people are still asleep, you know. Don't worry about that.
So, Bryn, I noticed that you're using a Windows machine on a lot in your screenshots. Have you used Windows high contrast mode at all?
Good question. Only for testing stuff. Okay. I don't use it. Which is interesting, I suppose. I haven't really questioned myself on that one. I just find myself not using it. I believe it or not, I did actually used to design websites, and I seem to think I've got this keen, you know, eye for design. So anything that's going to take things away from the original kind of intent is something I don't really like to do, which I'm fully aware is a complete contradiction into what I've shown you today. But yeah, I don't really use the high contrast mode. But you've reminded me just to point out that me being an Android user is by no means representative of, say, WebAIM survey results. The vast majority of people on mobile phone are using iOS and Safari and not Android and Chrome. So I think that is something, just to remind everyone that this was very much a personal, you know, what I use, as opposed to talking about a single group.
Yeah, I think that's a great point.
Yeah. Yeah, but also I think you also in the assistive technology space, there's definitely high contrast mode. There's, you know, adjusting line height and font settings and things like that that we didn't look at today. I'm trying to think what else is on there, but yeah, there's definitely more considerations than just making things bigger in screen readers, for sure.
Yeah, and my question was in no way meant to imply that would be a good option for you or anybody else. I was just curious.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. Well, with that, I think we're going to wrap this up. Again, Bryn, thank you very much for your session. We had a lot of people talking about it on Twitter, which is a great sign.
Fantastic.
They liked it, usually. So to our listeners, if you like this session, hit the YouTube like button. And don't forget, you can subscribe to youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 for future notifications. I assume through the software, not through a hand delivery. A reminder that Inclusive Design 24 is brought to you with thanks to our gold sponsors, our gold supporters rather, Barclays Access and Intopia, our silver supporters, Adobe and Site Improve, and our bronze supporters, Samsung Internet, DQ Systems, and the Paciello Group, and it's captioned by My Clear Text. Inclusive Design 24 will be back on the hour with Checks Notes, Eleni Beveratu, and she will be talking about accessibility in type and typesetting. Stick around for that talk, if nothing more than to hear her correct how I mispronounced her name. Thank you all, and I'm trying to figure out how to turn this off. Thank you all. We'll see you all on the hour. Cheers. Cheers.